Thank you for joining this session. I'm here with Atlanta Fed President Raphael Bostic. Thank you so much for joining us today. I wanted to start right in with what's on everyone's minds with Omicron and what you feel that that may do to the economic trajectory and particularly to what, how the Fed might need to handle things.
Well, first of all, good, I guess good morning for everyone in the U.S., and it's really good to be here. I want to thank you for the invitation to talk. In terms of the economic trajectory, I would say it's really a mixed bag. On one hand, it's extremely positive in the sense that the projections that I had coming out of the pandemic were that the economy was going to really rebound quite slowly, something similar to what we had seen in the Great Recession or the Great Financial Crisis. But instead, what we've seen is a pretty robust jump back by employment and in GDP to levels that we're only 2 years away, short of 2 years from the event, and we're almost back to pre-pandemic levels across the board, and that's very positive. The one area, as you know, that has been a source of concern for me for quite some time has been the inflation numbers. Now, I did want the inflation to be higher than it was pre-pandemic. We were in the 1.6, 1.7 range, but we're at levels that are much more elevated now, and that, as you know, is one of our metrics. So we want to make sure that we're on top of that and try as possible to make sure that that doesn't lead to longer run troubles.
And how does the advent of the new variant change things? Does it make you more worried about inflation than you have been?
Well, you know, it's hard to say. A lot of this will depend on how the variant actually presents itself ultimately. You know, we're very much in the early stages and we don't know what the variant will do in terms of its transmissibility or in terms of how lethal it's going to be to the population. And those things will ultimately play a big role in determining how afraid people are to go out and engage in the economy. To go back to work and to do all the things that we do to keep the economy a vibrant place. So we're going to keep an eye on that stuff. What I will say is that some analysis that has been done at the board suggests that the successive waves of the virus they've all triggered slowdowns, but each one successively has led to a milder slowdown than before. If we follow that history, then we should be okay. There's a lot of momentum in the economy, and I would expect that we can continue to grow through this. But again, all of this will depend on what happens with the virus and what we learn in terms of how dangerous it actually is.
It also seems that each successive wave of the virus actually has a bigger impact on inflation. We're seeing it get worse and worse with each wave. Is that a worry for you? And does it make you perhaps even more eager to get on with a faster taper as you think about that at this next meeting coming up?
Yeah, so I don't know that I would really equate the wave itself with the bouts of inflation. Look, inflation is really about supply and demand dynamics, and price is sort of the revelation of that. And what we've seen over the past 2 years is a lot of effort to make sure that the demand of the American public has been able to be sustained. We've seen significant work on the fiscal side by the Congress, as well as work on our side from policy to make sure that people are as whole as they possibly can be, because this is an event that wasn't caused by excessive risk taking or anything like that. I think that's been successful and effective. And you know, looking forward, I'm not projecting that we're going to see the same level of support to families. And so I don't think that the demand supply imbalances will get worse than they have been historically through this pandemic. And so I'm not sure we're going to see that. In terms of what it means in general for inflation, I think that the uncertainty does have the potential to prolong our heightened inflation experience beyond sort of where my business contacts have been telling me it was likely to go, which is into the summertime. And the longer this episode goes, the more risk there is that we will see businesses and families change their view about what inflation looks like or will look like moving forward, and that's definitely a source of concern.
So what does that add up to in terms of your feeling about policy, in terms of speeding up the tapering of the bond purchasing program, and in terms of when you feel that rates might need to start rising?
Well, I've been on record to say that, you know, I think that we do need to be tapering our and winding down the bond purchasing. They've served their purpose. And in addition to that, it will provide us a good deal of optionality into 2022 as we get more data and more information about where the economy is, so we can start to think about when the appropriate time to do liftoff and start increasing rates should be. I will tell you, in my SCP, the last one, in the dot plots, you know, I had put in one rate increase for 2022, and I had been there for a while because the economy has surprised to the upside consistently in terms of employment, and given the inflation position, I think that's appropriate. The question for all of us will be, you know, where do the numbers come in through 2022, the first half and into the latter parts? If inflation stays elevated, and I just saw an OECD projection this morning that suggested that inflation in the U.S. could be above 4% for the year of 2022, if it's at that kind of level, I think there's going to be a good case to be made that we should be pulling forward more interest rates increases and perhaps even do more than the one that I have penciled in.
And starting our, you know, is it important that the taper finish well before you start the liftoff, or can that happen around the same time? Where are you thinking there?
Well, I've had in my head for a while that I think it's good for us to do one thing at a time. And in this instance, I think we want to finish the taper before we do anything on interest rates. Now, of course, you never say never, but I have to say I'm struggling to imagine a scenario where we would want to be moving both of those together. So for me, I'm going to really take the view and really advocate with my colleagues that we should be thinking about, let's get the taper over with, and if the data come in strong over the next several days and weeks, let's get it over with sooner rather than later. And then we will be in a position to let the data inform when liftoff should be and how we act subsequent to that.
And just to be clear, get it over sooner than later. You mean perhaps by March rather than June, as it's on pace to do at the moment.
That's right. So I think having this finished sometime toward the end of the first quarter would be in our interest, and it'll give us a bit more leeway to do things if the data come in either hotter than we expected, but also, if it comes in even softer, then we have the luxury of saying, look, we're going to let the data inform us. And you guys, it will be very clear exactly what we're looking at to determine when we should act. I don't think there will be big surprises when we choose to do that.
Let me just ask just a little bit about the data. We're expecting some jobs data tomorrow. How important will that be as you assess going forward? Are you pretty much locked, you pretty much sound like you've made up your mind that you want to speed up tapering, so it ends in the first quarter. Tell me how important are you looking for a particular number there?
Well, I guess what I'm looking for more is continued momentum in terms of progress for employment. You know, the last several months we have had a bit of choppiness. I think the September number came in a little, August or September number came in a little lower than we expected. But when we looked through the numbers and looked deeper, we didn't see a slowdown in the momentum. And that's really what's the most important for me. I want to make sure that we are continuing to get signals that the economy is on firm footing, that it is continuing to grow, and that its ability to stand on its own feet gives us the opportunity to step back and let the economy actually stand on its own feet. And so we can pivot and be prepared for what's going to come in the future.
How are you thinking about the tension between, You know, the two mandates that the Fed has, keeping prices stable, obviously they're rising quite quickly now, a little bit too quickly, and getting to full employment. Do you feel that you're seeing that tension now? And are you worried that you may need to start raising rates before you've really fully seen the labor market come back to its full strength?
Well, let me answer this in two ways. You know, first is, right now, I actually don't see that there's that tension in the sense that, look, our policy is maximally stimulative at this point. The actions we're going to do over the next several months are not actually going to be putting brakes on the economy. It's just that we're not going to be providing as much stimulus as we had before. So we're still trying to facilitate that positive momentum that should translate into jobs growth. So right now, I don't see that we're facing that tension. That may come down the road as we progress and start moving our interest rates, but I don't think that we're there now. The second thing that I want to speak to is around the labor market. And just to keep in mind for everyone that the labor market is in a tremendous amount of flux. Look, we've just had a pandemic. We're still having a pandemic. And it's posing unprecedented choices for families, and it's put them in situations that many of them had never imagined before. And when I talk to people, they're still figuring out what their long-run relationship to labor markets are going to be. And you can think about families with children. They've just had, many of them, a year and a half or 2 years where both parents were home. They didn't have to pay for childcare. They didn't have to do a lot of the things. And they're rethinking, do we need both of us to work? Or is there a pathway whereby one of us can stay at home? A researcher at our bank has done work that shows that the group that has come back the least relative to what we expected in the labor market has been women with young children. And that speaks to what happens with childcare, what happens with the status of the schools. And those things have not all been sorted out. So there's a lot of churn that's still happening. There's a lot of turbulence. And getting a sense of what maximum employment looks like and what we should expect as a benchmark for that, it's going to take us some time to figure that out. And you know, we're going to continue to do that. We have lots of surveys. We engage with people in all walks of life. And as we get a clearer sense of that, I think it'll be easier for us to really speak to the tension that you mentioned in the question.
But it sounds like, you know, we're now about five million jobs short of where the economy was before the pandemic. And it sounds to me that what you're saying is based on people's life choices, perhaps, as they've changed through the pandemic, that you might be satisfied with a labor market that is, you know, has fewer jobs by the time you start raising interest rates and call it on maximum employment, that maybe it will just be a different thing. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah, I mean, we may be in a different place. And, you know, I will just tell you that this is one of the areas where my team of economists here at the bank is doing a deep dive to try to figure this out. As I said, we have so many moving parts. I didn't mention, you know, the retirement wave and the great resignation that people talk about. There's just a lot of change that's happening all at once. And we're going to do our evaluation and assessment and be open to the possibility that the maximum employment may be, in the aggregate, a smaller number of jobs, but it could also be larger. And, you know, we'll just have to see how that plays out.
Let me ask you, just throwing it forward to once you get started with rate hikes. I know you talked about you have had one rate hike penciled in. It sounds like you might pull maybe perhaps one more for next year as you submit your SEPs this coming meeting. What about in 2024? What about that rate hike path? Are we going to see gradual and slow as we did last time? Are we, now that we've seen inflation so high, are we going to start seeing it really ramp up a lot faster? What's your rate path view at this point?
So right now, I have us going, like, my path is to go slow and steady, to get to sort of the neutral path. And that happens, I think, in late 2024, early 2025. It's way out there. you know, because they ask us to tell what that's going to look like. Like, for me, I think there's a lot that's going to happen between now and when we get to those points in time that will inform how we move forward. I'm hopeful that what will happen is, as we start to move our policy, a number of the pressures and tensions that have emerged in the economy due to this COVID episode will start to resolve themselves. And that will then put significant downward pressure on inflation and get us back into a band that I'd personally be more comfortable with. If that doesn't happen, then we may have to take more strident steps. But I'm going to let the experience and the reality on the ground inform my decision making as we get there, and really try to keep my fingers on the pulse of what businesses are thinking about and how they're approaching everything that they're doing in terms of pricing and their supply chain strategies.
And just thinking about it, it does sound like it's inflation, that side of the mandate, that you'll be keeping your eye on mostly as you calibrate the rate hikes, rather than worrying about the maximum employment. Is that also, is that the way to think of it? It's prices are really top of mind for you at this point?
Well, I think first of all, we have a dual mandate. And I think we've been clear for quite some time that both sides of the mandate actually are an issue for us and a concern. Right now, employment is evolving in a way that is quite positive for us. And so if you want to think about sort of how to view the landscape, you always get drawn to areas that seem to be posing a higher risk to your ultimate success. But that doesn't mean that you're demeaning a focus and attention on what's happening on the other side. So, you know, I talk a lot about employment today, or inflation today, because inflation is above where our benchmark is, and the trajectory is not as positive in that regard as I would like. But just before I gave a speech on inflation, I was talking about labor markets. I was talking about how do we think about maximum employment. And that stuff doesn't go away. So I don't want to call this an either or. We're going to try to, as much as possible, stay focused on both and be ready to make sure that our policies advance our goals in both dimensions.
I also wanted to ask you about your thinking about the balance sheet, and the size of it, and how you feel that ought to be handled as you finish off with the taper and start thinking about liftoff. What about shrinking the balance sheet down? Where are your thoughts there?
Well, you know, I think that it would be appropriate to try to get the balance sheet to be smaller than what it is right now and what it will be when we complete the bond purchases. The increase in the balance sheet in the last 2 years, it was a response to a very particular episode. And it's always been my view is that you do what's necessary to deal with the risk that the episode poses. And then when those risks abate, then you remove the policies and you try to get back to where you were before that happened. I think that's going to be my objective and goal in advancing policy. Now, there are lots of details around do you shift the mix of the assets that you have? What's the pace of trying to normalize the balance sheet? And, you know, frankly, I haven't given that a lot of detailed thought. You know, I want us to get the first part done first. But in the next several months, that's going to be something that I work with my team hard on to have a view. And I will say, though, my goal is for us not to be static at this new level that was triggered by the pandemic.
I did want to ask you, sort of moving back to QE and the prospect that you may decide to, having just decided to begin the taper at this next meeting, may decide to speed up the taper. Do you feel that having set out QE at a set rate of $120 billion a month, and you know this will continue for until you reach these benchmarks, that kind of boxed you in a bit and gave you a little less flexibility than maybe you would like to have now that inflation is rising so fast? And how has your thinking on that evolved?
Yeah, I don't think so. When I think about that policy and all of our policies, frankly, I think about it in the context of the reality that we're experiencing something that's unprecedented. And in that context, I don't want us to be so secure and assured that we know what's going to happen in the future that we act briskly and perhaps are too proactive in terms of taking actions. So for me, going through this whole episode, I've been very in favor of us showing some patience and waiting longer perhaps than some might, because there's just stuff we don't know. Like this, like the Omicron, the emergence of that really, for me, hammered home the fact that there's still a lot of potential risk out there. And I don't want us to have, in hindsight, pulled back so fast and preemptively in ways that didn't acknowledge that risk. So we're gonna keep our eyes open. I'm gonna keep my eyes open. I'm gonna watch carefully what happens with this new variant. But what I will say is that the data as it has come in over the last several months suggests that it may be appropriate for us to pull forward a liftoff. And if that's true, then I think we need to have that optionality by getting the taper taken care of and finished sooner rather than later.
So it sounds like you're telling me a couple of different things here, though. I mean, if Omicron does, and we'll learn a lot more about it in the next few weeks, if it turns out that if it is more transmissible, it is more severe, we're seeing, I know we may not have lockdowns here, but there may be lockdowns in other parts of the world that may affect our supply chains. I mean, are you going to try to keep that optionality into your taper guidance even, that you could maybe go back to buying more, something like that? I mean, is that also going to be part of the discussion? Or are you really just headed to shrinking that?
Well, I mean, I think the chair has been clear on this, and I think all of my colleagues have as well, that we're going to let the evidence guide us. And if the evidence suggests that we're starting to see weakness emerge in ways that bond purchases can alleviate the pressures on, we're going to do that. And if we see evidence that suggests that the market and our economy is standing on its own and has enough liquidity, then we're going to continue to taper. And if we see evidence that liquidity may be leading to accelerated prices in ways that are uncomfortable, then we'll speed the taper. Everything is on the table. I'm open to all possibilities. And I'm really, as much as possible, just going to let the data guide me in terms of how I should think about what appropriate policy looks like.
Okay. I just want to change gears very quickly to ask you a different question. We have seen the renomination of Jay Powell and the nomination of Lael Brainard to vice chair. Have you been in contact with anyone in the administration about a possible spot on the Fed board?
So I have not had any conversations on this. I've got lots on my plate as we've discussed so far. So
that's not something you'd be interested in if the call did come?
Well, so there are lots of possibilities. I don't know what the White House is thinking about in terms of positions that they might put in front of me. But, they're all important jobs, and I'd have to just take them on as I had a chance to consider that. But, ultimately, right now, I'm just focusing on what I need to do, which is to make sure that our policy and my views are clear on this so that I can advocate them with the FOMC, and we can collectively get to a good outcome.
Okay, definitely wanted to get that one out of the way. I wanted to also ask you a bit of a longer term question as you think through after what I think you called would be a potentially gradual and steady rate hikes to some unspecified point in the future. Do you think that COVID has changed things enough, and this experience has changed things enough that you'll be back to inflation at 2%, and you will be more worried about fighting it from above, as you know had been the case for decades, than fighting it from to try to get it upward again, as has had been the case just before the pandemic. How do you think that's gonna all pan out, you know, as you look forward in your crystal ball?
So I think there are reasons to expect that the inflation dynamics will be similar to how they were pre-pandemic, but I also do think they will be changed. And in ways, I think that will pull us closer to the 2%, it'll be higher than they were in the past. And the reason I think this is really some of the conversations I've been having with business leaders who have told me, look, we were working at maximum efficiency. We had a just-in-time model for how we got our inputs to products. And that's the lowest cost approach. But it also, we've discovered through this, it presents a risk in terms of the ability to provide goods if there are disruptions in any part of the chain. And we don't like that. That's what I've heard from businesses across the board. And so many of them are starting to explore whether they need to change their supply chain strategies from just in time to just in case, which would be a higher cost basis. And that means that the change in cost over time would wind up being a little higher. So we'd wind up with higher inflation. What I'm not hearing are people saying that shift, to the extent that they do this, is going to lead to a wholesale change in how they think customers will see their products. And so they think, from what I understand, they can do this, keep the economy growing strongly, keep employment growing robustly, and have just a slight increase in inflation. Now, there's a lot of ifs in there. Like, I don't know how many businesses are ultimately going to pull the trigger and move to that new strategy. That's the type of stuff that we're really going to try to monitor moving forward. But there's been a consistent articulation that I've heard from the business people that I've talked to that's definitely on the table and is something that they're going to explore in the months to come.
Yes, I mean, it's fascinating what could happen to the economy, what could happen to inflation. Just also pulling back sort of geographically, I know that you with the Fed, that your job is to take care of inflation and employment in the United States. But obviously, your decisions here, whether it's with the taper or with liftoff, affect countries globally. Do you see risks of the taper disrupting, you know, markets, affecting particularly emerging markets, and do you worry about any spillover back to the states as those effects work their way through other countries?
You know, I don't see that happening right now. When I look at the landscape, I see plenty of liquidity in the market, and our pullback should not have an adverse impact on those things. Now, if there were developments that did trigger negative things in overseas markets, those could have implications for us because so much of our supply chain is connected. It's a global economy, as you know. So that stuff I'm definitely going to have to pay attention to. But right now, I don't think that our assets are change in posture of our asset purchase program is going to likely drive that kind of negative impact.
And what about the rate hike path? Is it, if you come to the point where you're seeing data coming in that makes you need to move faster or more sharply, is that a concern for you as well? You're thinking about the international landscape as you make your adjustments and how they could wash back into the United States.
Well, we will definitely keep an eye on that. And I will say that, you know, it is a global economy. We've got to do what's best for the U.S. Primarily, but we do need to be mindful about echoes that happen such that the U.S. can be adversely impacted. Again, all of these things are things that we monitor in real time and try to minimize as much as possible, and we'll just continue to do that.
Okay, well, that's great. And then just one final question for you. Are you feeling, I guess maybe my question for you is, do you have less, are you getting better sleep now these days than you did earlier on in the pandemic? Or are there still, you know, things like Omicron that really make trouble for you?
So I'm definitely sleeping better. I feel like I've learned a lot more about the dimensions that we have to have a view and understanding about. And I think about this in two ways. One is clearly in terms of policy, but two is also in terms of my staff. Like, we have had our policies evolve in significant ways at the staff level, in ways that I think will keep my staff safe, will keep them healthy, and will allow us to be more productive. And it's those things that have given me a considerable peace of mind and allow me to sleep better. There's plenty of uncertainty that's still out there, but I feel like in a lot of ways we've positioned our team as well as the U.S. economy to be as resilient and robust as possible.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us today. It's been a really great conversation.
I really enjoyed it. Good to see you.
Nice to see you too.